This is a video on the standard error. What I'll be talking about is first kind of the general idea of the standard error. How do we interpret the standard error just as a number? Then we'll look at the relationship between the standard error and confidence intervals. And then finally, we'll take a look at the relationship between the standard error and hypothesis testing. So let's start out with an example. And the example I have is we want to find out the population mean amount of water per hour that marathon runners consume during the event. So when I say we want to find out, you can't get the exact population mean, but we can get a confidence interval for the population mean amount of water per hour that the marathon runners consume during the event. The recommendations will be 30 ounces per hour. And that's according to at least one doctor that I read about recommended 30 ounces per hour for marathon runners. If a marathon runner drinks too much water, then they get overhydrated and that could be dangerous. And if they drink little water, then they get underhydrated or dehydrated, and that's also dangerous. So the question we might also ask is, does the population mean differ from this recommended 30 ounces per hour? And that'll be a hypothesis test. So let's start out with the standard error just in general. So remember, the standard error measures standard deviation of the sampling distribution. So it tells us that if we take samples and we look at the sample mean, then the standard error will give us an idea of how much one sample mean is likely to vary from another sample mean. And even more importantly, how much the sample mean is likely to be different from the population mean. So it tells us how good our estimate is. The central limit theorem tells us that the standard error, sigma sub x bar, is equal to the standard deviation, sigma, divided by the square root of the sample size. So in particular, if n is large, if we have a large sample size, then the denominator will be large, so the fraction will be small, so that tells us the standard error will be small. So increasing the sample size decreases the standard error. Let's take a look at a couple examples. So the first example is, let's suppose that we surveyed 35 people, 35 marathon runners. Let's suppose that the standard error was 11. So remember, the recommended number of ounces was 30. So our estimate for the population mean is likely to be off by as much as 11 ounces. If the recommended is 30 and you're off by 11, you almost have no idea how much water the marathon runners are drinking on average per hour. So in particular, we want a larger sample size because we need a smaller standard error. If we only want to be off by, let's say, around 1 or so, then we need to divide this 11 ounces by around 10. But because of that square root of n, to get a standard error that is lower by a factor of 10, we need to increase the sample size by a factor of 100, because the square root of 100 is 10. So 35 times 100 is 3,500. So if we get a standard error of 11, we should be very sad, because it means we have a whole lot of work to do. We need to really, really ask a whole lot of marathon runners, maybe 3,500 or so, to get the standard error to be close to 1. On the other hand, let's suppose that our sample size is 35 and our standard error is 0.5. Now we're talking about being off by a half an ounce of water. I don't think a half an ounce of water is going to kill a marathon runner in either way, a little too much or a little too little. So in that case, our estimate of the population mean is only off by a little bit, not a problem, and we're very happy with the standard error because it tells us that the sample that we took, its sample mean is likely to be very close to the population mean. So we should be very happy because the sample size is large enough so that the sample mean is likely to be very close to the population mean, and we have good information. So now let's look at confidence intervals in the standard error. This gets a little technical, but definitely worth looking at. So remember that when we're working with confidence intervals, as long as we have a large enough sample size, typically over 30 or so, then the sampling distribution is approximately normal. And the standard deviation of the sampling distribution is the standard error. The mean of the sampling distribution is the population mean. So let's suppose that mean were 27. Then if we had a large sigma x bar, then that would tell us that the normal distribution, like this reddish curve, is very wide. Because if we have a small sigma x bar, like we have in this blue-green curve, then that would mean that the normal distribution is not very wide, it's very narrow. So for example, in this reddish curve, if the standard error was 2, which is about what it is, and the 95% confidence interval, we would say that we need to go out left and right so that 95% of the total area is between the two numbers. We're going to have to go as far as maybe 23 to 31. So the confidence interval for the population mean number of ounces that marathon runners would drink is somewhere between 23 and 31 had the standard error been 2. On the other hand, had the standard error been about 0.75, like in this blue-green curve, then the 95% confidence interval, we don't have to go out very far to make sure that we have 95% of the area in this region. And in fact, it's about 25.5 to 28.5 will be that confidence interval. So we can see we have a much more narrow confidence interval. It's really important because if we have a confidence interval, the population mean between 23 and 31, not very useful at all, because remember the doctors are suggesting 30, so it could actually be a little too much drinking or a lot too little drinking in terms of the population mean amount of water that marathon runners drink. So the standard error is way too big to get good data, to have good information. So again, because of that, because the standard error is too big to have good information for the confidence interval, we're going to have to redo this with a larger sample size, which remember is a lot of work. On the other hand, to say the population mean is somewhere between 25.5 and 28.5, that's informative. Now we could say that runners, yeah, they're not necessarily dangerously low on their hydration, but they're a little lower than we recommend. So maybe we should have maybe an extra water stop and recommend that the marathon runners grab that drink of water that maybe has 2 or 3 ounces of water, and that'll put them in that range so that they're in a healthy range. There's no need for a redo because we have really good information on how to help these marathon runners. So finally, let's talk about hypothesis testing. This is also a little complicated, but it goes with the same kind of idea where the standard error really, really affects the width of the normal distribution that we're working with. So in particular, in the red curve, when we had the large standard error, when we're dealing with hypothesis testing, so for example, H naught mu equals 30, H1 mu not equal to 30, we put 30 right in the middle of the normal curve, and the standard error tells us how far left and right we ought to go, or we need to go, for this normal curve. So in particular, in the red curve, we have a very wide red curve, and we're interested in the p-value. So if, for example, the sample mean were 28, 28 is 2 away from 30, so 2 to the left is 28, 2 to the right is 32. So if we look at the area on the far side of 28, on the left of 28, we add that to the area on the right of 32, that gives us a p-value. That is the definition of the p-value. And in this case, if we combine those two areas, we get around 0.14, which is a pretty big p-value. We're not so happy with that. When you have a sigma sub x bar equals 2, we got the p-value of 0.14. And then we fail to reject the null hypothesis. Standard 0.05, for example, for a level of significance. And we're not very happy about that. On the other hand, if we're dealing with a small standard error, then the normal distribution is tall and narrow. And then if we look to the left of 28 and to the right of 32, that's this yellow little region, we'll notice that combined area is really small. That's because the standard error scooted these values in to the normal distribution. So in particular, this p-value is around 0.01. When we have a p-value of 0.01, because the standard error was 0.75, that gave us that small p-value, we reject the null hypothesis, and we're much happier. So in summary, with a standard error of 2, we failed to reject the null hypothesis. Therefore, we're unhappy with the standard error, and we need a bigger sample size because we're still hopeful, because 0.14, although it's bigger than 0.05, it's not super big. So we're still hopeful, but we're sad because we know we have a whole lot of work to do to get that big sample size so that the truth can be revealed one way or another. On the other hand, with the standard error of 0.75, we rejected the null hypothesis and we're happy with the standard error. We're able to say with statistically significant evidence that the population mean is not equal to 30 ounces. We could say that action needs to be done in terms of be educating the runners about 30 ounces is really good. Let me give you one last little example. Had we gotten a p-value of 0.97, so had most of the area been shaded, then we would be happy with the standard error because the truth has been revealed. It's pretty likely that the mean really is 30, or at least really close to 30, and we wouldn't need to redo the study with a larger sample size. So hopefully you get, after seeing this short little video, that knowing the standard error is absolutely important in terms of samples. It tells you how far the sample mean is likely to be from the population mean. It influences the width of the confidence interval. If we have a small standard error, then the confidence interval will be a lot more enlightening than if we have a large standard error. And it helps reveal the truth for hypothesis testing. If we have a very small standard error, you're typically either going to get a very small p-value, at which case you can reject the null hypothesis and say you have statistically significant evidence, or you could say your p-value is so big, it's time to give up and maybe do some other study that has nothing to do with what you're looking at. Whereas if the standard error is large, then you're likely to fail to reject the null hypothesis. And even if your hypothesis was correct, you're not likely to find that out. And that tells us that if you have a large standard error, you're much more likely to get a type 2 error. So that's all I have to say about the standard error. I hope this helps show you what the standard error is all about and how important it is. Have a wonderful time researching hypothesis tests, confidence intervals, and especially the standard error. Goodbye.